101 WROI, WROIFM.com. Streaming audio live, RTC Channel 5. Audio and video soon on RTC Channel 4. Hi, Elizabeth.
Hello.
Welcome back. Yes, nice to have her in the studio. And we go across the console where we can say good morning to Mr. John Alley, President, CEO, Woodlawn Hospital.
Good morning.
Nice to have you back with us.
Hey, pleasure being here.
Excellent. Meeting yesterday, trustees.
Had our board meeting,
right.
So kind of do a little update for them. One of probably the major things that we started the meeting with was we're looking at last Friday, put in the visitor restrictions. We've seen a tremendous increase in the amount of influenza A, and just kind of hit all of a sudden. And we're kind of one of the last hospitals in the area to really put those restrictions in place. So they'll hang around until we get our levels down, and I'll get with our health nurse who works with CDC and kind of determines when we need to lift those restrictions. So, you know, just be aware, if you're going to visit somebody in the hospital, if you're under age of 18, we prefer you not to come in. If you're having flu-like symptoms, a cough, a fever, again, you know, just go ahead and stay home. And really, we're trying to restrict it just immediate family members in there. So if it's your next-door neighbor, give them a call, but probably stay home because we're trying to curb much we can. And what's concerning, you know, to all of us right now is not a lot of folks in town right now because of the spring break we've had with the school corporation, and we've seen a very large increase during this period where they're gone. So when everybody gets back, we start getting concentrated again, the kids in school. We're hoping that we don't see then a real blossom in influenza A. So just be aware of that. You know, if you are experiencing the flu-like symptoms, contact your physician. We've had several folks, you know, come to the ER, and unfortunately, nothing we can do for them. It's one of those, it kind of has to run its course. So if you're concerned, you got flu-like symptoms, give your medical provider a call and say, hey, here's what's going on. Sometimes they can call you in a script for Tamiflu. Doesn't make it go away. It just kind of lessens the severity of that flu. So there's really nothing we can do for it.
Is this the type of flu that the flu shot would have prevented?
Yes. And what we're seeing is a lot of the folks that are coming in did get the flu shot. So maybe of every about 5%, but a vast majority, no, I didn't get it this year. You know, it didn't work last year, and it didn't. The flu shot was not very effective last year. So they didn't get it this year. So we're seeing that it's kind of a late peak in that, in the flu season, and it's statewide. You know, when we contact other hospitals, everybody's seeing a dramatic increase here in the past 2 to 3 weeks. So we're hoping we get through some of this early springtime stuff and see that fall off again as we move into warmer summer months.
People forget how contagious flu can be.
It's very contagious, and you know, it just makes you absolutely feel rotten for about 3 or 4 days. And unfortunately, again, not a whole lot we can do for that. There's, you know, because it's I think it's a viral, so there's no antibiotics that will work against it. You just kind of got to run its course, and you feel miserable. Tamiflu does seem to help a little bit with that. So again, if you're experiencing those flu-like symptoms, give your medical professional a call. Tell them what's going on. Now, they might say, nah, there's more than just the flu. They'll want to see you. But, you know, coming to the ER, unless you're, you know, got other symptoms going too, if it's just the flu, like, not a whole lot we can do for you. And, you know, they get angry, come in, think we can fix it, and then we say, well, there's not, you just need to go home. So kind of avoid that trip because you'd feel rotten anyway. Why get out and move around?
And you'll let us know when the restrictions are in.
Absolutely. Okay. Once we get to that point, and it's based on a formula that CDC puts out of number of cases per population. If it goes over 2%, then that's when they usually invoke that. So we'll be monitoring that as we see these hopefully start dwindling off, then be able to lift those restrictions. But because, like I said, the concern is everybody out of town for spring break, when they all get back and the kids all get together in the schools, I'm kind of afraid we might see another spike in that come early to mid next week.
Okay.
Also, you know, last month we talked about an upgrade to some of our patient monitoring system, and cardiopulmonary, we tried to apply that same technology to them, and it just wasn't going to work. So we actually had to go out and look for a new vendor to provide that type of monitors for the cardiopulmonary. The board did approve that yesterday, so we're hoping within the next 90 days to replace those monitors down there also. And that's a vital part of our basically watching you when you're in the hospital. So if you're coming in for stress tests or whatever, this is what monitors your heart rate and everything, and we can keep an eye on that. So
okay.
It's time to get some new ones in there. We've kind of got the end of life of the ones we have, so we need to replace those. The other thing that some of the staff wanted me to talk about is we're starting our prenatal education classes again. We've kind of dropped those off for a while. So they're coming back. let's see here. I'm trying to read my note. Saturday classes are scheduled from 9 to 1, and lunch is provided. The topics is the pregnancy, labor and delivery, newborn care, postpartum care, and an actual tour of the OB department. Our dates for 2019 are April 6th, May 18th, June 29th, August 10th, September 21st, November 2nd, and December 14th. Now, I know there won't be a quiz later. So, the only thing you need to remember is the phone number. So, if you do have some questions on the prenatal classes, it's 574-224-1250. And it is free to, you know, any mothers that's going to be delivering at Woodlawn, you know, partners, support people, whoever they want to bring in. You know, we did this for a while, and it kind of, you know, got put on the back burner. It's a very important thing. Take some of that tension away. You come in, you kind of see the department. We try to explain what that process is. So when you come in, it's not, oh my gosh, what are you doing next? Kind of walks you through that and gets you prepared for that the event when the little guy finally decides to make his appearance, so you're well prepared.
Well, I think you hit the nail on the head. This is kind of an important thing for folks to be aware of and to go through.
It's very important, you know, not only the education classes, but also prenatal visits to your physician. You know, that's an important part of your body's changing, and there's things that you need to do and things you need not do. And by talking with your physician, they can monitor that as you go through your pregnancy. And so at that time comes, you got a nice, healthy baby, and everybody goes home real happy for a while until the nights of crying. But it's a joyous event. And
exactly.
We want to try to help folks through that process. Educate them what are they getting themselves into, because you know at that last minute when you come in, if you haven't had that, you're in labor, we see that tension, some fear, well, what's happening next, what's going on. This will help get you through that a little bit.
Excellent.
And then we finally got into the financial report for the month of February. Had gross revenue about $11.5 million, deductions of $7.2 million, had other operating revenue. This is things not directly patient related, so classes, if we do charge for classes, stuff like that, about $90,000. Had operating expenses of about $4.7 million. Non-operating income, again, that's some income generated from some other areas outside of the hospital, of $220,000. So we actually did have a net loss for the month, about $124,000. Not unusual as we get into months February and March. I think March is going to be, my prediction is a fairly substantial loss, just from the fact spring breaks here, a lot of doctors. When I was looking on our schedule, we had, six physicians gone during the month of March. So, that dramatically affects us because, sometimes the patients go, oh, I'll just wait till they get back to go see them. So we're seeing some delays there. So we're expecting March to be not a very pretty number. I tried to prep the board yesterday, be prepared for a fairly substantial loss. But as we go through the rest of the year, we hope to make that up and get back on that positive side by the time we get to year end.
This is pretty typical for this time of year, John, isn't it?
Very typical for this time of year. Yep. One thing that, again, we're looking at the flu, we're trying to prepare for that because we are anticipating next week a fairly dramatic uptick, maybe in office visits. Folks will get home, and traditionally, every time, even without flu, that first couple weeks after everybody comes back from spring break, we do see an increase in physician visits because, they've been, Florida or wherever and got some different bugs that they're not used to before. And by the time they get home, they've incubated quite well and usually need to see their doctor. So we do anticipate some increased volumes from that. Hopefully it's not the flu. It is something that we can treat and get you on your way.
Okay.
And that was pretty well the board meeting.
John Alley, President and CEO, Woodlawn Hospital. And I know, John, that you maintain or still maintain a relationship with some of the area nursing homes, right?
Yes. We still have got, probably 8 or 9, I think, nursing homes that we have an affiliation with where by working into, we've taken over the license for their beds. And what that does is helps them leverage some state dollars to get additional federal monies. And they can't do it without a government entity. And since we are chartered as a county hospital, we're classified as a government entity. So we work with them to take some of these monies locally, apply that to federal. So it's a 2-for-1. So for each dollar we put in from the state level, we'll get 2 back from the federal government. And that's been very helpful to those nursing homes. They've used it for expansion projects. We work with them very closely on quality measures. We want to make sure that, they're doing what they need to do. And it's, kind of statewide. We're not the only hospital doing that. Quite a few of the county hospitals are doing that. And it's been a very beneficial program for those nursing homes because again, you know, they're even more restricted than we are as far as what funds they get. This allows them to have an additional influx of cash to come in. And like I say, they've been using it for a lot of nice projects to make the life for their residents much better than what it was before. And we're happy to participate with them. We've just done some education at some of the nursing homes where they've called and said, hey, our residents, can you come in and talk about, you know, a disease management? More than happy. We send our nurse educators to the nursing homes, and we'll sit down. I think the last one, they had 28 or 29 residents that wanted a topic to be discussed. So we did that with them. So, again, it's a very good relationship that in years past, there's always been that kind of an us and them between hospitals and nursing homes. And now I think we both understand a little better what the other person does. And that's, I think, helped our staff because, you know, they were as guilty as anybody, oh, here comes a nursing home. Well, no, now they understand the difference between what they're up against and what we're up against. And I think it's really solidified that relationship, even with the local nursing homes that we don't have that affiliation as far as owning their license to their beds. We still work with them, and I think that's what's opened this door up statewide for nursing homes. It's made a very, very important improvement in quality care for those residents in those homes.
Does this help Woodlawn as well?
It helps us also.
Okay.
But, you know, we take, basically we share in some of that money. The biggest portion we give to the nursing homes because that's what the program was designed for. We keep a little bit to help with our costs. And so, yeah, it does contribute to our bottom line also, but the majority of the monies do go to the nursing home. That's what it was designed for. You know, that's what we're here for, to help them improve their quality of life for their residents, and so that's what we do.
Take a second and tell us about Woodlawn's relationship with Compassionate Care.
Compassionate Care, that's something that was started quite a few years ago. Myself and another gentleman in town kind of sat down and said, what can we do for those uninsured? And what we found is, you know, there was a fairly large population that were too proud to say, I don't have the money to get quality health care. So they just get nothing. And we were seeing, you know, heart disease, high blood pressure, diabetes was kind of spiking. So we decided, let's open up a free clinic. And so the hospital works with them very closely. We help fund some of them. We give, help them each year. They come and make a presentation to our board, and they'll make a grant, so to speak, of X number of dollars to help with that operation. And that, you know, we've seen a fairly dramatic decrease now in some of those very manageable diseases that were coming to the ER via an ambulance, say a heart disease, diabetes, high blood pressure. They're getting early intervention now by able to go to that compassionate clinic, getting the meds they need, and we're not seeing them on the back end. So to us, you know, it was dollars well spent. If we can spend money up front to keep you out of the ER, keep you healthy, that's what we need to do. And I think that's they've served a great purpose in the community. They, you know, past couple years with some of the, you know, health insurance plans, you know, they only take those who without health insurance. So some folks got on that. Well, then Indiana last year, a lot of those plans went bankrupt. Now we're seeing an influx of those folks. I sit on the board for there. Some of those patients now coming back because they don't have health insurance. They have to have some place to go to help them with these manage these diseases. And, you know, we've got Jamie Parker's, our nurse practitioner there, does an excellent job. We've got several of the physicians through the Woodlawn family that donate time there to see patients. So, you know, that's what, again, that's part of our mission, I think, is the well-being of our community. So board very graciously supports them. We work very close with them. You know, again, by me sitting on the board, we kind of have that interaction that, here, we're seeing, you know, this disease now in the hospital. So now they're aware that they might start seeing that coming into the clinic. So, again, very big boon for the community. But again, it operates 100% off of donations. So, you know, if you have, you know, some extra money, like, sure, you know what to do with,
sure,
you know, please call Mary out at the clinic and say, hey, can I make a donation of $5, $10? Every dollar helps because that is totally free for those patients. We work with drug companies to try to get free drugs for those patients. So, again, it fills a niche in our community that was going unlooked at several years ago, and we're seeing a difference that clinic's making in the lives of some of those folks that just don't have the means to get the health care they need, and we're getting that early prevention and early, you know, control of diabetes that, if unchecked, causes serious medical conditions down the road. It's much easier to get you on your insulin today than 5 years from now we're having to do, you know, either amputations or whatever because you've let that get to that point that we can't, you know, save some of those, you know, the toes. Everybody hears about, you know, the diabetic ulcers and the vision. unchecked. This gets that early on prevention. And I just can't say enough about what they do there. It's the clientele is very appreciative that come in there. And, you know, just give them a call.
Well, I'm sure that they've got their own set of rules and regs, and anybody interested in finding out more about it, as you suggest, give them a call.
Just give them a call.
Sure.
You know, we're looking, I think, trying to maybe open it up outside of Fulton County, because we're seeing there is a need outside our county borders. And so we're trying to look at other clinics around us. How close are they, and can we coordinate with those? There is a need out there. There's people that are not getting the proper medical care because, you know, and they've told us, well, I don't want to go to the ER because I know that costs a lot of money and I can't afford it. I can't pay it. So they purposely stay away. That's the people we want to see get you in there, get you treated, so it prevents that long-term disease or maybe lengthens your life. Who knows what all some of these early interventions can do if we look unchecked 10 years from now, where would they be?
John Allish, President and CEO, Woodlawn Hospital. John, as always, we appreciate your time this morning. Thank you very much for the report.
I have a pleasure. I love coming down here.
Try to keep people in Fulton County and the surrounding area as healthy as you can, will you please?
You know, that helps them, but it hurts my bottom line. But no, again, I've said before, our job is to put ourselves out of business, and we're working to that. If we'd love for everybody to be absolutely healthy, don't need us, and just carry on. But unfortunately, we can't get to that point. If you need us, we're here to serve.
John Alley, thank you very much.
Thank you.